Okay, so I'm joined by former Arsenal and Fulham midfielder Ian Selley. You're okay?
Hi, Ian. You okay?
Yeah, I'm great, thanks. How's Dubai?
Yeah, it's been fantastic for us. We've been here 2 years now. The Arsenal schools are running very, very well. Some good players on board. Obviously, at the moment, sometimes we're hitting temperatures sort of mid-40s.
Yeah.
Had a temperature of 56 degrees when I was in the car the other day, so that's pretty, you can't do too much, to be honest with you, but I think we've got another month of this, and then the school will start back up.
Okay, we'll come back onto school later, but we'll just talk about your career for a little bit first. So, who spotted you on your way to sign for Arsenal?
I was playing for a local team called AC United, and the boots did fairly well. Our age group, and we had a lot of scouts come to watch the cup finals and stuff, the big games, and I just got taken out to Arsenal one day a week. Pat Rice signed schoolboys, done well enough to sign for a YT, he was in them days. And he only signed, I think it was only five of us that were in my age group. Roy Parler was the year above me, Paul Dickens was even above me. So we had a good sort of group of players to play with and train with on a day-to-day basis. And then obviously signing first team, making a debut at 18. So it's been, it's just one of those clubs that I've been with for a long time. Not to get youth, sort of different other clubs. You realise how good that Arsenal club was. You've got the title as a player, but the history the club's got is it's very enjoyable being there.
Yeah, so as you said, you made your debut at 18, and there's a squad full of future club legends like Ian Wright and Alan Smith, Ray Parler, Tony Adams.
We had a good side. I wouldn't say we were amazing players, but we had lads that had a great team spirit, worked hard for each other, obviously socialised hard as well. But you're allowed to do that, though. But it was a good time. I'm happy that I was involved with them boys, because obviously being a young lad coming in, it's a bit daunting sometimes, making appearance all these stars and that. But they looked after us, and I'm going to look back and I had a great time there, great time.
So was it the end of your first season that we got to the League Cup final?
I think I played my second game against Leeds United. We were beating 3-2 at the road after extra time. Made it to get to the final, so it was, for me it was a...
Even though you only made the bench of the League Cup final, it must have been amazing just being in the squad for the game at the old...
Yeah, part of it, so I was lucky enough to play in the semi-final against Spurs.
One of our listeners has sent a question in about the Cup Winners' Cup final. So, it's from Yakatama. Yakatama, that's the name of the person who sent the question in. You were part of the last Arsenal side to win European silverware. How did George Graham motivate the side when you were considered large outsiders against Palmer?
We had quite a tough run into the final, to be fair. Back to Paris Saint-Germain. But playing against good sides and good players. And I think with George, it was, it was obviously taken very, very seriously, but I think he took the pressure off the players. So he knew he had a decent bunch that were organised, weren't obviously the sorts off for each other. We were just hoping that, we might get one or two chances in the game and that. And then pretty much just sharp-shot. Obviously, on the back four, Nixon and Winterburn, Bolton Adams, who were pretty solid there. Very strong, physically. To go into a final like that, obviously, they had some superstars, Sprilia, Rowling, that's a great
player. Zola was playing as well.
It was a tough game. But I remember coming out of the change room, I was so fired up to the game. And obviously, when we had to walk out to the pitch, the fan base we had there, we pretty much took over the whole stadium. It was unbelievable to them.
Because Ian Wright was suspended for the final, and John Lee Jensen was injured as well, so it's kind of a bit of a depleted squad, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was sort of, obviously, what we got booked in the semi final for kicking out to them on them. Yeah, it was always going to be a tough game for us, and we had John Jensen as well, which was in the first thing, and obviously, the one at the time, it was,
unfortunately, in a game against Leicester in 95, you broke your leg, which has kept you out for over a year, wasn't it? So that must have been devastating, such a early in your career.
Yeah, it was a tough time. You know, you sort of all these sort of medals come thick and fast in the first sort of few years, and that, and you sort of see how it's continued. But I've been in a lot of tackles before and got away with it. But this time it was not a bad tackle. It was just one of those, one of those things. And it was a long, long process. It was a double fracture. I had a pin put down the machine, which internally got infected. Then I had to have my machine drained over, I think it was about a month. I was in hospital for a lot of weight, and I picked up septicemia as well, so the chance that might have even took the leg off, so it was it was a tough time, to be fair, because obviously being a young lad, you're fit, you do whatever you want, you're sort of pinned in hospital, and obviously family and friends were visiting on a regular basis, but it was just it's very difficult. I mean, even the rehabbing from it, it takes its toll. You get some ups and downs, but I'm just glad that I've sort of come back from it. A lot of players that probably wouldn't be on it was a tough time.
Okay, and was that the season Dennis Bergkamp signed for the club? Was that 95-96?
Yeah.
So it was a huge buzz around the club.
Sorry?
That must have been a huge buzz around the club when you found out he was signing.
Well, obviously you sort of do research on players that come to the club and as soon as you step foot on the pitch, his first touch was unbelievable, and obviously people, when they watch him play, they say, he's brilliant. But when they see him training on a day-to-day basis, it's even better. He's frightening, but he was such a nice guy as well, which I think the superstars in them days seem to be a little bit sort of big time, and it was he'd always be first on the training pitch. He'd always be the last one off the training pitch, playing out from free kicks and turns and this and that. So when he does, when he does nothing, it wasn't just a one-off type thing. He worked hard on that, all through his time that I was there anyway, so for a young lad to look up to someone like that, I know that when I sort of moved clubs, I was always the first one in, the last one to the edge, I learned a lot from it,
Yeah, and you mentioned the culture at Arsenal in the early 90s. When Arsene Wenger came in, was it an instant change in the culture?
Yeah, I think obviously socially he clamped down on the players by the end of the game, there's no beer in there. There's a dressing room, normally under George, win, lose, or draw, there'd be a crate of beer that gets put out, and all that. The boys are doing yoga, there's a creatine that a lot of players were sort of taking. I think you just educated the players, I think at the time, I think all the boys were obviously enjoying themselves on and off the pitch, but obviously when you come in, I think you prolonged a lot of the lads' careers, not only played far longer than he probably would have done if he carried on the way he's going, and that's the same. Ray Parler as well, another one. So the whole thing changed, and obviously the quality that he's bringing in over Miles and Elka, Vieira, the Petites, he brings some good quality players. So it was a tough time when he said to me that I wasn't wanted, sort of come and made an offer for me, which he was happy to accept. But he was fair, and I knew, come back from injury, I wasn't quite what I was beforehand. No. I think it took its toll a little bit. So, but it was tough to leave the club. There's some nice people there, but But as soon as he turned up, the whole training regime changed. Everything was, the sessions weren't, we only talked about the sessions were quite prolonged, like the people per session. And he'd do it for an hour.
Yeah.
Whereas Arsene would do it sort of 5-6 minutes, so one was flat out, and then he stops, drinks, and the chat, and then he got back into it. So it was all, you know, the tempo was all sort of 100 mile an hour, because it was plenty of breaks in between. But I think sometimes when you're doing something for 45 minutes, after 5 minutes, a lot of the lads have switched off and, you know, not get anything out of it. So, I thought, you know, obviously Arsene had a great job there. You know, I know he's been under a bit of pressure, but, you know, I'm glad that, you know, obviously last season was a good season. Hopefully, this one did better for him, if not better.
Yeah, I was going to ask, they've had a iffy, decent start to the season, but a couple of iffy performances. What's the expectations this season?
I think the good thing about Arsenal now is maybe 2-3 seasons ago, if they wasn't playing well, they wouldn't get a result. But last season, especially, even though they wasn't playing so well, some games, they were still going down some points. So there's a hearty feeling in the team at the moment. I think just the way you see Arsenal getting interviewed now, he's more positive, the players seem to be positive. I think they're real good atmosphere at the club. You know, Chad has been there for a long time, so, you know, obviously, last season, I think before the season started, if you'd have said that Arsenal would finish where he finished, they would have, you know, won the FA Cup, you wouldn't have said no chance, you know. So, he's brought a couple of boys in as well, so hopefully it'll be, another good season. But it's one of those early days, and, you know, Man United are obviously dropping points, and, it's early days, but hopefully they can settle into a routine and, get cracking again.
Okay, so as you said, you moved to Fulham in 1997. A couple of games in, tragedy struck again, you broke your leg again, apparently.
Yeah.
Was it the same leg, or was it?
Same leg, it was about an inch below the previous fracture.
Yeah.
It was like a stress fracture. It was probably. I was before even more upset because obviously knowing what I'd gone through at Arsenal, coming back, rehabbing, and obviously you're at the club all day, every day, in the gym, you know, trying to get yourself back. And then, you know, I moved to Fulham, which, you know, was at the time Wilkins and Keegan over there. And obviously, outside was the backup, and also the go places. So it was as a career move for me, you know, dropping down two divisions, it was a good move because, you know, the club had money to get good quality players in. I was enjoying it. I was having a good game and just waiting for a tackle and obviously felt a lot of pain trying to carry on and end up coming off and unfortunately had a stress fracture and that probably kept me out for probably a good couple of years, you know, because obviously I was worried that I might not come back at all. So again, it was a very long sort of physical fitness program, but obviously mentally it went as well. You sort of, you know, your character definitely gets tested, you know, sort of ups and downs. And again, it's one of them. I'm proud that I've, even though I might have sort of dropped down the leagues after Fulham, at least I did come back, gave it a go, and, you know, in touch with I managed to sort of carve some sort of career out after that. So, you know, it was a tough time, but again, you know, Fulham's another nice club, you know, a couple of tasks to us. So I'm always sort of looking out for their results as well when they come out. So, it's a long time ago now, though.
So how did you job come about working in Dubai? Is it working with the younger players or something you wanted to do?
I was playing sort of non-league, and I was doing some coaching at kind of non-league clubs and got involved with academies, and it was something, you know, I knew that the legs were slowing up a little bit, and I was getting a little bit heavier, and things were, you know, trying to motivate myself. Situation in the non-league quite difficult, you know, if you had the players that don't take it seriously. But I loved it there, but, you know, I went to the coaching side, and then I spoke to Steve Morrow about, is there any Arsenal roles anywhere around the world? And he said there was a job in Oman, there was a school there, there was one in Greece, which is the non-league academy, and one in Dubai. So obviously Dubai, you know, initially sort of stood out, so I've done a bit of research on it. Steve got us flown over to Dubai for an interview. And I think they wanted someone with a bit of Arsenal DNA. I think they wanted someone who, you know, maybe players and parents can relate to, who's been at the club for a long period of time. So, you know, it's a great move for us. Obviously, it was quite stressful leaving the UK, but the wife had just finished her contract at work. So we thought, you know, let's go for it, you know. We'd love to get out of the world. All we have is it's fantastic. You know, we've really enjoyed it. And also the school. down from strength to strength. It's been down 5 years now. We've always been, you know, sold out. We've sort of a good group of players that we're working with. So, but obviously, the social boys coming as well as good quality players, so we're sort of working all the way through. But things began really well. You know, there's a lot of competition to buy, some score wise. But I still believe that we're up there and we're the best.
So how does it work? Is it like a club atmosphere, or is it like you come in for like a couple of months sessions?
I've got 12 coaches, and we try and run it as close to the academy as we can. You know, the training is very similar. Obviously, we've got social players from the age of 5 years old to 20-year-old, so we can tailor the sessions with those boys that aren't quite as strong as the other ones. But yeah, it's all about, you know, the kids obviously enjoying themselves. The training ground we have at the rugby centre, is unbelievable. You know, it's a premiership training ground.
Yeah.
The pitch is perfect, the facilities there are unbelievable. We've got restaurants there, you know, it's crazy there. You know, if the kid gets bored, we, you know, but like I say, when I took over there, there was a bit of a holiday camp type thing going on with the players. They turn up and pretty much want to do what they want to do, so we had to, you know, sort of work on them to make sure that when they do come in, they're going to work, they're going to enjoy it, but at the same time, they're going to come in and get something out of the sessions. And now, you know, it took about a year to install it, but now the lads come in, you know, whatever ability level they are, they know they're going to come in, enjoy it, but they're also going to go away a better player. So it's been really good, and we've had some good feedback as well, good feedback.
Okay, and how does the technical ability of the players compare to your English counterparts?
Technically, some of the boys are very, very good. Technically, they're a little bit weak. You know, I don't know whether, you know, the UK boys seem to be a lot stronger to sort of the local boys here. Whether, you know, I think the kids here get, you know, quite a sport lifestyle. You know, a lot of them have got drivers, nannies, maids.
Yeah.
And obviously do a lot of things for them. So they might get a little bit soft, you know. But, you know, the quality of it here is very good. I don't think it's quite up to the standard of the UK. But again, we obviously have got some lads that I want the clubs come and see, you know, because, you know, we have sort of, every term we have probably 400 players come through, all age groups. And there's some lads, obviously, that we've seen that we've marked down that I think deserve an opportunity. Because in Dubai, the local teams, the professional outfits, you're only allowed, I think it's 3 international players, so they tend to go for ex-premiership players that are on the verge of retiring, they can have a nice paint packet, and so it's hard, it's so difficult for the lads here that are good. There's not really any channels they can go to. You know,
yeah.
Worked on getting a couple of boys out to Spain to get scholarships there. So you know, I'm trying to do the best we can for them.
Okay, I'll finish on a couple of listeners' questions and then I'll let you go. So, Crimey asks, any plans to move into management in the future or become a Arsenal coach nearer to the first team?
Yeah, it's definitely something that I'd like to do. Obviously, it's one of those, you know, I'd love to stay within the club. You know, it's like I say, it's a great club. I've been here, obviously been involved with the club for a long time now. And, but I think if the right job come along, I think, you know, it has to be the right job, the right chairman, the right club. I've seen a lot of ex-players that have dived straight in, and I think the first job's the hardest one because if you don't do so well, obviously, you know, your CV doesn't look so good, so you need to make sure that had a few offers back home and sort of on leave, but decided to sit down because obviously it wasn't quite right for me. But yeah, it's something, I'm 40 years old now, and it's, I'm enjoying myself over here. You know, I'd like to stay here a bit longer, so we just have to wait and see on that one. You know, obviously there's a lot of competition now, a lot of obviously ex-players coming through that, you know, want to make that same move. So you obviously need to make sure you know your stuff, and but it'd be good to stay within the Arsenal framework, definitely. Maybe go back to some sort of YouTube role over there and take it from there.
And he asks, what do you think of the lack of Englishmen currently in the Arsenal squad?
Sorry, say again?
He said, what do you think of the lack of Englishmen currently in the Arsenal squad?
Lack of Englishmen?
Yeah.
It's a difficult one, you know. I think it should be restricted to the amount of foreign players involved. In the past, but you know, I think not just Arsenal, you know, the same as Man City, Chelsea. There's a lot of so many foreign players that are coming, which, you know, I've been which should obviously improve the Premiership, but the only worry behind that, I think, is the lads at the youth team level, you know, where do they go?
Yeah.
You know, do a lot of them, I think, fizzle out after they drop down to the Championship, Div 1, Div 2, but, you know, it's difficult to look at the national team now, you know, we're struggling, even, you know, I think in the next World Cup, I think, you know, we could be struggling again, you know, so something definitely needs to be done. But it's a difficult one because the fans, I think, like seeing the best players all over the world come to the Premiership and can watch them play, but at the same time, you know, the country needs to produce some young stars. So the FA have got their work cut out. You know, they've tried a few things recently, but you know, we seem to be sort of lacking, and we're sort of, you know, so far behind other countries. But you know, there's a few Englishmen that ask to put lights out. So I'd like to see a few more there. And I know that when I played a game against them, the youth after the youth team when I was at Lewis and the non-league for a pre-season friendly, and there was probably two British players in the team. It was like French, Portuguese, Spanish, Italian. It was crazy, you know.
It's
like, where are the UK boys, you know, gone? Where, you know, they moving? Just where do they go? You know, so something different needs to be done.
Okay. Well, thank you for joining us, and I hope you'll come on again in the future. I really enjoyed that. So.
Yeah, definitely. Okay. Yeah, no, enjoyed it. Yeah, definitely.